So let's get the show on the road. So, what is the status? CoalLog version 2. Well, just to go back a little bit in time, we successfully introduced the original version of CoalLog back 3 years ago, February 2012. And one of the key features of it was making it available for free download, and that was done finally through the AusIMM. It is an ACARP project, but AusIMM provided the webpage for us to make it freely available. The staggering thing is that there's been over 8,600 downloads of the manual in that 3 years. So it's out there. It's spread a lot further and wider than just the Australian coal industry, which is pretty exciting and interesting to see. We know that some software suppliers have implemented it and others have not. We hope that through pressure of the industry that those who've been a little recalcitrant will eventually adopt it and make it available to their users. As I say, international use and interest. The first full implementation of CoalLog was actually a project in Canada. So while we designed it, made it available for Australia, it has been used in Mongolia, Africa, Indonesia, as well as Australia. So that's exciting to see. You've probably heard and seen some of this before, as Brett and I've talked about it at various seminars and provided some papers. And part of the original intent was that it wouldn't be a static thing, but that we would have an ongoing review and improvement process. And that's part of what today is all about. So with the successful implementation 3 years ago, we were encouraged to go to a stage two and successfully receive the funds from ACARP for that. So just a refresh in case you're a newbie to CoalLog, it's a standard set of codes and fields for the collection of coal borehole data. There's a set of principles for the way in which that data is collected. We made a starting point of using existing Australian standards wherever possible and relevant. As well as the codes and fields, we provided some standard recommended templates for collecting that data for a variety of different sorts of data, but they were by no means rigid in terms of having to use those sheets. They were just recommended sheets. we provided descriptions of all of the codes that were provided, and a key aspect was having a digital transfer format so that made it easy for people to transfer the data between companies and between software systems. Codes and fields, we provided some standard recommended templates for collecting that data for a variety of different sorts of data, but they were by no means rigid in terms of having to use those sheets. They were just recommended sheets. we provided descriptions of all of the codes that were provided, and a key aspect was having a digital transfer format so that made it easy for people to transfer the data between companies and between software systems. So the objectives of stage two was to continue to revise and update those codes and fields and sheets. We wanted to look at adding photographs to the descriptions to help those. To get some codes for the major formations and the seams in Australian coalfields, to have some standardised plotting symbols for the presentation of the borehole data, to look at LAS files and standardising the metadata and the variable names that are presented in LAS files, and provide a training manual for geological and geotechnical logging of coal boreholes. So today is all about presenting the results from those objectives. We took the same approach as stage one. Again, we approached this by having some subcommittees. So I headed up the review committee. We had separate committees in New South Wales and Queensland to look at the stratigraphic and seam codes. Katie Pinetown looked after that in New South Wales and Graham Pewitt in Queensland. Brett looked after the plotting symbols and the LAS metadata. And Brad Crichton from Geological Solutions chaired the training manual committee. So I'm going to hand over now to Graham Hewitt, who's going to tell you something about the strat codes.
Thanks very much, Dave. My name's Graham Hewitt. I know quite a few of you in the audience, but just a brief bit of background. Before I retired and then got re-employed working with CoalLog through Brett and the LogCheck system, I work for Bowen Central Coal or Vale or AMCI, MIM, Rio Tinto and a few other groups along the way. So yeah, just a very brief background. Okay, what I want to do is just run through a brief description of the process we used in looking at trying to derive stratigraphic codes and seam codes, and then look at some of the details of that as we set it up. On the committee that we had formed, there was Kane Maxwell from Peabody, Nick Moore, Mark Biggs, Peter Green and Mark Thompson from the GSQ, Peter Handley and Greg Jones from JB Mining. We met about four times, I think, over the two-year period. And what we initially did was approach quite a few of the larger mining groups for some assistance in getting the codes that they were using, both for stratigraphy and for seam codes. And then we got quite a lot of data also out of the various consulting groups. I won't mention who we did and who we didn't get from. Ken Preston just caught me up there and wondered why I didn't give him a call back, but that's another story, Ken. So the process we used was to compile those pieces of stratigraphy, basin by basin, and then come up with what we thought was a fairly exhaustive series of codes and also the stratigraphy as well as the seam codes. I guess in my history, I grabbed an old 1985 booklet for some of the stratigraphy, and I was very pleased that the GSQ gave us a great deal of assistance in actually updating some of those names to the correct beds and formations and all of that information, which was very useful for me with an old text, that's for sure. What we did was compile those and then circulate them within the committee, get back together after some interchange of information and basically hone down the process that we wanted to agree, yes, we should add these codes in or not add these codes in. Let me compare the notes. So what we've ended up looking at is a 3 to 5 digit code for formations, a 1 to 4 digit for seams, and then some of the splits, we thought they were important, and then a few codes for horizons, such as basis weathering and other areas. Just some detail. One thing that halfway through the process, the New South Wales guys who had a similar committee were doing the equivalent sort of process for all of the basins within the New South Wales context. And between the two of us, we thought there's probably an idea to differentiate between states and or other provinces. So what we've done is to come up with an N prefix for New South Wales basins, a Q prefix for those in Queensland. And for those that have worked in South Australia, obviously there's an S code for those, Victorian. Occasionally we let the brown coal guys come into the equation, Tasmania and Western Australia. So there are prefixes for all of those. So one that we're all fairly familiar with here, Bowen Basin. So QBB is the code that we're suggesting to use for the Bowen Basin here in Queensland. Not a great deal of rocket science in it, but coming up with an exhaustive set of codes was nonetheless a bit of a frustrating process, as I'm sure Jonesy will agree. Stratigraphy. Again, I have to acknowledge the GSQ. What we basically did was adopt their 5-digit code system. That will, I think, make it a little bit easier when we're submitting data sets, metadata back to the department. At least those codes will be familiar to the Geological Survey. again, I'm not going to go into any detail, but these are just a series of codes, an example of some of the codes that are in the system or proposed to be in the system. Equally, there are some New South Wales ones. Seam names, what we decided was to really have it at a higher level. We didn't want to get into every split and every sub-seam that has been identified, but what we thought we'd do is identify the main seams that generally are used in the industry. So I guess by way of example, the Dysart seam, as we know in the Moranbahs, has got some riders and uppers and lowers and those sorts of things. So we've gone to that detail. But at the end of the day, we haven't gone to identifying in detail, as operations will do, the specific supplies and those sorts of things within it. So again, a series of codes that have been derived for that. An equivalent amount for the New South Wales seams. And I'm not sure why we only come up with five or six, but there's a series of horizon sort of things that we're suggesting as common codes that could be used across the industry. So base of weathering, base of tertiary, base of Triassic, top of Permian. And I know that's a lot to take in, but are there any questions?
Not so much a question, but a comment that the concept of the basin code was that there's now a field in the header of your hole that lets you specify what the basin is. The idea being that that will then assist looking up the codes for the various seams, because you will then know to just look up the seams that are in that particular basin. Going back, I think it was the New South Wales Geological Survey, they were wanting to like put the basin codes in with every seam name. Every time you used the seam, you had to sort of say what the basin was. But to get around that, what we decided to do is to actually have a field in the header that you fill in to say what basin you're in, which would then specify what seams would be appropriate for that basin.
Okay. Now, patterns and symbols. Now, this ended up taking a hell of a lot longer than I thought it would. Not because of a great lengthy discussion, more just the amount of time it took to come up with morphology patterns. What we've done, just in terms of terminology, the term pattern has been used for the overall pattern for a lithotype, and say that a pattern is made up of individual symbols. In the various documents that we picked up, sometimes the term pattern was used and sometimes the term symbol was used, and it all got a bit confusing. So for simplicity's sake, we decided on that terminology. Now, you'll know in CoalLog that it actually has a lithological qualifiers column and an adjectives column. Now, this was entirely designed on the basis that lithological qualifiers were items that were significant to the geologist about the lithology, other than its actual lithotype, whereas adjectives were items that were less significant. But how we actually, the distinction we actually made was asking the question, would the geologist want to see that information on a plot at a detailed scale? If so, then it needed to be in the qualifiers column. If it wasn't that essential to be seen on a plot, then it went in the adjectives column. So a typical example I'll give you we have the brightnesses and the coal brightnesses and the sandstone grain sizes are actually in the qualifier column, because the idea being that they're items that geologists want to be able to differentiate with on a detailed scale plot. Whereas items like in adjectives, calcareous or whatever. Which you don't want to see on it, that aren't important enough to see on a plot, then they went in the adjectives column. But the obvious corollary of that was that we needed to have a symbol for every lithological qualifier that we had in the dictionary. All right. Next question is, why was it required when we already have an Australian standard? Most of you have probably seen the Australian standard AS2916, symbols for graphic representation of coal seams and associated strata. But that actual document only covers 30 of the lithotypes and qualifiers that geologists use, whereas CoalLog itself defines 98 lithotypes and 115 different lithotype qualifier combinations. So it was only covered 30 of the approximately 200 symbols, items that we needed symbols for. Why do we want it? And why do we need a standard? You know, like everything else in CoalLog, the problem is we had different people using different symbols for the same litho type, or vice versa, for different the same symbol for different litho types, or different litho types for the same for a symbol and the like. And this is particularly important when you're actually looking at graphic logs, etc., produced, say, over a number of drilling campaigns that by a number of different companies where different symbols are being used, or where a consultant, which we're all consultants now, is jumping from project to project, and all of a sudden, you know, mudstone in one project, the symbol is siltstone in another. So, it opens the way for unnecessary errors by having different symbols for every different rock type. All right, now we set up some design guidelines, and on this one of the things we did, and what we did, we tried to, like we did with the original CoalLog codes, is we tried to grab ideas from various systems and get the best of every system. So one of the things we did was we decided to use the same symbol for a sediment that's unconsolidated, where a sediment can be either unconsolidated or consolidated. We use the same symbol, but in the consolidated version, we offset the symbol. So you can see here the example of silt, where silt and siltstone both have dashes and dots, but in the silt, we have all the dashes in a line and dots in a line, whereas in siltstone, they're offset. We'd seen that in a couple of systems, and we decided the reason why that worked was because that when the symbols are offset, the actual material looks more cohesive than when they're just in a row. So we adopted that guideline. I'm just jumping back a bit. Also, I've got it here with me. People say, oh, aren't everybody using the same symbols? And we did compile a whole list of the different symbols that we could find different people were using. And everybody I showed it to was flabbergasted at the number of different symbols. Apart from coal brightness, there was a fair agreement on that. Apart from coal brightness, though, it was flabbergasting to see how many different symbols were being used, even for fairly common lithologies. All right. Another guideline we have is symbols should not be too large or widely spaced, so that they're still legible for thin units. Patterns should not include continuous horizontal lines that could be confused with bed boundaries. And we decided, for simplicity's sake, to use the same symbol for cobbles and boulders, because we decided that it's applying the drill hole data, and trying to differentiate a cobble from a boulder geologically in a drill hole is fairly unlikely. So why bother? Difficult. So why bother going to the difficulty of having two different symbols? So just to cut down the number of symbols we had to come up with. All right. Now, this is more for the computer geeks who are implementing the stuff. But I actually needed to explain, especially to them, that there's two types of patterns. There's non-proportional patterns that have a fixed size individual symbol, which are repeated across the column area, and proportional patterns that have symbols whose size and position is relative to the width of the column area. So the example I give here is that here's a carbonaceous siltstone. You can see the siltstone pattern just repeats itself. So if you've got a wide column, you just get a lot more repeats of the siltstone. Whereas the carbonaceous indicators, which are these black columns, their size is proportional to how wide the column is. As I say, this is more detail for those that are implementing it rather than for the user. All right, and the other guideline we used, or convention we used, was that where you've got interbedded one rock type with another. This is fairly standard practice. You just actually showed both rock types next to each other for the unit, and the line here was proportional to the proportion of each of the rock types or litho types. So we've got 75% siltstone and sandstone and 25% siltstone. I just used the term rock type. In one of our earlier meetings, we actually decided not to use the term rock type, but to use the term litho type. And the argument for that was because engineers don't know what a litho type is, whereas they know what we were talking about if we were using the term rock type. All right, how did we come up with the patterns that we were going to use? All right, so what we did for each litho type was to examine the following list that I'm about to show you for patterns. And if I couldn't find a suitable pattern amongst all these items that I found, all these pattern sets I found, then I set to designing a pattern that was appropriate. So the first thing we relied on, obviously, was the Australian standard. So if a pattern was available there, we grabbed it, except for a couple of cases where the pattern actually didn't fit in with the guidelines that we'd actually set ourselves. And then we went to the AusIMM Field Geologist Manual and looked at what patterns they had. Then we had a look at the sets of patterns used by large Australian coal companies, which I've listed there. And then if we couldn't find anything out of those, we then went to a number of sets of patterns we found from foreign organisations. So there was the USGS, the United Kingdom Geological Society Engineering Group, the British Geological Survey, Shell's Exploration and Production Division. And then, interesting, one of the best set of patterns we found was from the Ethiopian Ministry for Mines and Energy. You'd think Ethiopia would have better things to do, the government would have better things to do with their money than designing plotting symbols for geologists. But all right, as I said, for a lot of lithotypes, quite an array of patterns were used for the same lithotype. Where no appropriate pattern, where there wasn't one, then I tried to use some aspect of the lithology to come up with a pattern. So here's the set of patterns that we've come up with. So we've got clay, mars, sand, gravel, cobbles, boulders, alluvium, colluvium. Oh, over here on the right, I've described where the pattern has come from. And if I've designed the pattern myself, where there was no patterns anywhere else, I've described what the logic was in designing them. So, for example, there was no cobbles or boulders, so we just used the gravel pattern with larger circles. Alluvium, colluvium, diatomaceous earth. This is the symbol that was in the USGS for diatoms. I don't know what a diatom looks like, but I'm assuming that it must look like something like that. Interestingly, the first release of this, or for draft of this, I actually had fill and spoil the same as sand. And Mal Blake said, oh, you really need to have something to differentiate it. And I jokingly said, oh, what, shall I put a drag line there as the symbol? And that then prompted me to use miner's picks as the symbol for fill and spoil. Fire clay, that was my effort at some fire flames amongst clay. Loam, soil, coal, lignite and brown coal. Very occasionally we've used the same symbol for two items, so lignite and brown coal has the same symbol. Peat, which came from the engineering group, in the UK engineering group. Coaly items had the sedimentary rock shown behind it with a big thick black bar for coaly. Similar for carbonaceous, and we've got two thin bars. This was one I came up with, which was oil shale, little blobs of oil on a shale symbol. Tar sand, which was blobs again on a sand symbol. Sedimentary rock undifferentiated, which meant to be a cross between a clay symbol and a claystone symbol and a gravel symbol. Claystone, pellet claystone, which was just some of the clays look like pellets. Mudstone, shale, siltstone, sandstone, conglomerate. Now, one of the things which wasn't a big deal up here in Queensland when we developed the CoalLog standard, but New South Wales had a big demand for being able to specify whether the conglomerates were greater than 65% matrix, 35 to 65%, or less than 35%. So these are the various symbols I managed to derive for representing those different items. Breccia, Fort Breccia, diamictite, that came out of the Shell standard. Tillite, again. Calcrete, for calcrete and siltcrete, I just came up with this symbol, which was just a crosshatch pattern that looked fairly hard to me, denoting the fact that things hard, with a C for calcrete. Chert, cone and cone carbonate, well, that's fairly obvious how I came up with that. Ferrocrete, fossil wood is just like, meant to be look like wood on its side with little limbs. Ironstone came out the USGS. Now, kaolinite's a clay symbol with K's on it. Laterite's just L's. Tonstein is just T's. All right, igneous rock undifferentiated. Where it's undifferentiated with the igneous material, we've just got a random pattern. So we've got a random pattern of just long bars for igneous rocks, a random pattern of V's for volcanic rock undifferentiated, and a random pattern of plus signs for intrusive rocks. Acid felsic rocks. The logic I came up with for differentiating between acid felsic, intermediate, and basic mafic was to spread the symbols more for acid felsic, and as you went more to mafic, to compress them together, just to give a darker colour to the overall symbol. As you go from felsic to mafic, you get a darker looking rock. So I thought by just having the same symbol, but not different sizes, just the same symbol, but compressed together to represent how felsic or mafic the rock was. Similarly with intrusive. And then we also then applied that logic to all the individual petrological names for igneous rocks. Okay, tuff's there, tuffites there, and volcanic breccia. And then the one I had that took me probably some of the most time was metamorphic, because there was hardly anything around for metamorphic rocks, which was not a real concern of ours, but you know, it took a fair bit of time. The logic here is going from less metamorphosed to more highly metamorphosed. So the more highly metamorphosed it is the more wavy it is. And then for minerals, there was nothing much for minerals, so I used the logic of trying to draw a symbol that represented the crystal structure of that mineral. So I had to go back to my second year geology university textbooks to find out what the crystal structure were of the various minerals, but then came up with some patterns that actually looked like the crystal structure of the various minerals. And then we've got the items like core loss, missing records, no records, old workings, which is a big W, void, which is a big V, etc. And those ones are stretched out to fill the entire space. All right, moving on to the qualifiers and the patterns for qualifiers. We've got things like clay silty, clay sandy. So these are all derived by actually having the clay symbol at the same density of symbols as clay was, and then to have that overwritten with some silty symbols, but not at the silt symbols, but not at the same density as silt. So it's saying that it's clay with some silt in it. So we've got clay gravelly, silt clay. Silt gravelly. So you can differentiate between clay, silt clay and clay silty by the fact that the silt clay has a lot more silt symbols in it and less clay symbols in it, and vice versa for clay silty. Then we went to the sands, fine grained, fine to medium, and fine to coarse grained. Now, one of the logics here, I've actually seen quite often examples where they've just used fine and then a wider space pattern for fine to medium, and then a wider one for fine for medium, and a wider one still for medium to coarse, and a wider one still for coarse. But really, if you've got something like that's fine to coarse grain, what that actually infers is you've got layers of fine grain and layers of medium grain and layers of coarse in it. So instead of just having a single spacing, what I've done is fine to coarse actually shows that by having a layer of fine, a layer of coarse spacing, and a layer at medium spacing and a layer at coarse spacing. The other problem is that with a lot of symbol sets is if you actually have different symbol spacings for fine to medium, medium to coarse, and coarse, what sort of symbol do you then use for fine to coarse grain? So that was a bit of a dilemma that this solved. All right, we go gravel clay, gravel silty, gravel sandy, gravel, and then gravel fine to medium, fine to coarse. And so, yes, where we've got gravel fine to coarse, we have some fine symbols and some coarse symbols. Gravel medium, medium to coarse, coarse. Cobbles clay, cobbles silty, cobbles gravelly. Boulders clay, boulders silty, boulders gravelly. All right, then we get into the carbonaceous stuff. So we've got coal undifferentiated. And then we've got the coal brightnesses, which is about the only thing that all the software seems to agree on, how to show the brightnesses, but not quite all the software. I won't mention names, but there are some that just, there are certain software we came across that actually had different pattern for each of the different coal brightnesses, which I thought was novel. Coal saprolipoic, coal dull, coal coidal, coal anthracite. That was a symbol that I came up with that was looked very coaly, but differentiated it from bright coal. The other thing we did was we introduced coal heat affected, coal coked, and coal cindered. The idea being that the central bar is white in these heat affected coals, but depending on how wide the white bar is, indicates how heat affected the coal has been. So we go from heat affected to coked to cindered. Coal fusainus was that symbol, which I derived from the coal cindered symbol. Coal stony was in the old standard the coal inferior symbol, but CoalLog doesn't have a coal inferior. Going back a few steps there, we took coal inferior out because the problem with coal inferior is that it doesn't actually tell you how it's inferior. Is it inferior because it's stony? Is it inferior because it's weathered? Or is it inferior because it's heat affected? So coal inferior, and I've been asked this a few times, is still in the CoalLog legend, but recommended not to be used. And the only reason it's there is for old data where you don't know. But if you're logging core today, you shouldn't just describe it as coal inferior. You should either describe it as coal stony, coal heat affected, or coal weathered. Anyway, using the old coal inferior standard symbol from the standard, we took that and then overlaid it with some sandstone symbols. This is coal weathered out of the standard. Coal extremely weathered. I think it's fairly obvious how that came about. All right, so, and again, like previously, or if you've got a coaly of each of the different sandstone grain sizes, you can show that with just the coaly bar across there. Similar with carbonaceous. And then similar to the unconsolidated sand, we've got these, now we've got the sandstones for the various grain sizes. Again, as I said before, you know, these are offset one line to the next. And conglomerates tended to actually have all the range of grain sizes. This was one of the most time-consuming parts. So if you're really keen on it, there's a different size, as you can see there, all sorts of different pattern combinations for different combinations of conglomerates in terms of class sizes and percentage of matrix. So quite an array there. And then finally, we've got the tuffs. All right. All right, next. All right, so, and we'll speak a bit later about this, but all the stuff you see today, we were hoping to get up on the web by today, but we haven't quite managed that. But we're hoping that most of it will be up by next Friday, the AusIMM website. But to facilitate the implementation of the different patterns, we're going to put the patterns up on the web page in a number of different formats. So they'll be up as the PDF that you've just seen. But we've managed to get some soft. They're currently sitting in DXF files with a different file for each pattern, and we've managed to acquire some software that converts that into bitmaps. Well, originally DXF. Enhanced PostScript, HPGL2, JPEG, and SVG, which is standard vector graphics. So they'll be up there in all those formats. Again, that's more for the implementers rather than yourselves to be too concerned about. Any questions on that? Yes?
Yeah, Brad, no, you haven't used colour at all.
No, the situation with colour was that in our original proposal, colour wasn't in what we said that we would do. And like all these things, in the last few months of the work, the only document out of all those other documents I showed you earlier that had a set of colours for different rock, a number of the documents had different colours for different geological ages, but the Shell document actually had a set of colours for different main lithology groups, you know, like limestones and the like. And they all looked fairly good to me, and so I sort of copied them out with some minor changes and distributed distributed them to half a dozen people that give us feedback, and got a flood of feedback of why they didn't like those colours. So we've put that in the too hard basket just at this stage. Though the feedback was good, there were some good suggestions as to why they shouldn't be the colours that Shell was using, where Shell didn't have a rock type, I'd added a colour. But I think that's going into it'll be a CoalLog version 3 or whatever. So we got somewhere with that, but decided that it was in too early a form for acceptance. The idea wasn't to have a colour for every rock type, it was to have colours for more or less groups of rock types, I guess. I mean, I know I remember in our first discussions about CoalLog, it was pointed out to us by the geotech people that the geotech people are far more interested in the unconsolidated material than the consolidated material. So we did actually bend things away from what some of the standard geological procedures were for the unconsolidated material. But I must say we haven't done that so much in the pattern sort of thing. But I can really only go, because I'm not quite aware of what's available, I can really only go on John Simmons' feedback. So, but, you know, we like all these things, nothing's absolutely frozen in time. So if you have got feedback on that, you know, we're happy to look at it and see where that differentiates. Yes. Can't say we did, no. That's an interesting thought. Any other questions? Yes. Yes. Right. Okay. That's interesting. Yeah. One of the interesting things that came up in one of the latter meetings, but after we'd progressed a fair way, is we had somebody from Ventix or Mincom or whatever they call themselves now, who was from the Ukraine, and she came up with a document that was all in Russian, where for years she said she was amazed when she came to work in Australia that all this wasn't defined. Because in typical centrally planned governments, for years they've had not only a symbol set, but, you know, little diagrams telling you how many millimetres wide each symbol had to be and in great depth. And so, you know, she said, you know, they were doing that in the Eastern Bloc countries for the last 20 years. So I was surprised that it wasn't happening here. Yes, Ken? Yep.
At one stage I tried to sort of run a concept there, and we actually had what I call consolidated topology. In other words, all fine grained sediments, all coarse grained sediments, all acid, etc.
Yeah.
So that you could say rather than, you know, I want to see 120 sediments, only want to see the maximum sediment.
Yep.
And then I can see the overall.
Well, we've done that in one sense, but not as much as you have there. In the fact that you either have used the symbols for the lithology, or you can use or on a general scale plot, which groups together all the sandstones just as a sandstone sort of thing. Doesn't show the grain size, or you can actually, when you're doing a detailed scale plot, I know it's not exactly what you were doing there, but do a detailed scale plot where you actually then go to more detail as to what the different symbols are. So it does that to a certain extent, but not as much as you are doing. And I actually think that's a good idea. It's actually something I've seen done overseas more than in Australia. Yep. All right. Yep. Yeah. Well, we've got 98 lithology patterns at the moment. So, yeah, I think that's a worthwhile comment. I think that's a worthwhile comment because we, as I say, we have still got, even when we go to the general scale, we've got 98 different lithology patterns. And as coal geologists, something's igneous. You probably don't care what it is other than the fact that it's igneous, you know.
The other thing is that you can use colour.
Yeah.
Okay,
Yes, Barry.
Yeah, but just a question on the, I know this is set up for the borehole sort of logs.
Yep.
How do you see that might apply to geological cross-section?
Let's put it this way. We've limited, you know, obviously it's rather difficult for, say, to show coal brightnesses in any way on a section. And I guess we have the out that coal logs meant to be a standard for borehole data.
Yeah,
yes, I had thought about exactly what you're saying, and some of the patterns do come across very well to be able to put on a section. But yeah, the obvious example is coal brightnesses. How the hell do you show coal brightnesses on a section? And, you know, and something I had thought about, but hadn't got anywhere with that thought.
Feel free to take the lead.
Yes.
Feel free to.
I must say, when the last downturn happened in the coal industry, I was working in the hard rock industry. And I was actually, because 3D printers have been around for 20 or 30 years, it used to cost a fortune. And I was just amazed that in the hard rock industry, no one had actually been using 3D printers to build their ore bodies that are such weird and wonderful shapes. And you know, mining companies usually have a lot of money to do that sort of thing, but no one was doing it. And I've always thought that'd be where 3D printers would be extremely useful, where you've got these very weird, odd-shaped ore bodies. Yep, Dave?
One way to help differentiate bulk sediment types would be to put out a list of recommended background colours.
Yeah.
People wouldn't have to stick to them. Your symbols still differentiate from each other.
That was our concept. The concept with the colours, we weren't going to be... The concept when we did look at colours was it wasn't to actually say that you necessarily put the symbol in that colour, that maybe you'd want to put the... The idea also, if we introduced colours, there's going to be no compulsion about colours because you may have situations where you can only work in black and white. But when we were thinking along the lines of colours, my thought was that you leave it up to the user whether they actually colour their actual symbol or whether they use the colour as a background. And from my experience, the colour as a background is far more effective than the colour on the symbol. As I was reiterating there, this is not anything that's going to be frozen in time or whatever. You know, it is a standard, but as much as we possibly can, in the CoalLog, we've actually had further suggestions for various aspects that we've knocked back because we don't want to change the system too much. But if people have got a good argument for why something needs to be changed, the review group is happy to, you know, move forward and change it. But you have to have a good argument because we don't want to change the system unless somebody's got a good argument.
So onto the training manual. This is the one and only copy in the room and it's going home with me. You can see why we didn't produce one copy for every person here. But in your packs you have got a printout of the list of contents of the document. So hope you find that useful and encouraging to download it and make use of it. And we do hope to have that up on available through ACARP or the AusIMM very shortly. So stay tuned. So let me take you through the development of this and how we actually got to that huge tome. As I said at the beginning, we had a committee of people. I haven't listed their names for you here, but when we get to the end of the presentation, there's a number of people that are thanked for that, including all the people that were on that committee. And I might say now too, if you look and don't see your name on that list and you expected to, then my apologies. We had certainly a lot of people that have contributed to this development over the last couple of years, so remembering everybody that made a valuable contribution has been a little bit difficult. So that was just some acknowledgement at the end of those who have helped us. So the committee initially determined what is going to be in and not in the document, and then we set about, as I said, using the principle that we'd started with, which was to use what was already out there. So we issued the request to companies to provide the manuals that they already had for their field logging procedures. And to try and keep up with the times, we thought we'd set up a Wikipedia-type page which would initially enable the committee to upload and review and edit the document as a live document, and then obviously make that available. Well, this is what actually happened. We found that very few companies were prepared to make their manuals available, and we ended up really with about three or four at the most that were made available, some in their entirety and some just in parts. We did find it difficult to actually use the Wikipedia site, both in terms of people weren't actually contributing much to it, and editing was a little bit difficult, shall we say, and putting useful diagrams and pictures into it was difficult, and we weren't making any progress with doing it that way. So we took that down and reverted to using an old-fashioned Word document, which obviously meant that was a little bit more clumsy in terms of proceeding, but it did really make the process a little bit easier in terms of coming up with something that was going to be deliverable. But because we both got sections of this from various sources and in various styles, it took a considerable amount of time to edit and rewrite it to get it into a bit of a standard style and presentation. So, as Brett indicated, with the development of the plotting symbols, this took a lot longer than we really originally anticipated. But this is what we've got. So, as I say, I hope you find it useful, and I'll just take you through some of the main parts of it. So, the objective of it is obviously to provide a document that graduates or young geologists or new people to Australia, coal borehole logging, can go out into the field with or be trained with before they go out into the field, which might be even better, using general standards and procedures that are used in the Australian coal industry. And as I've emphasised, we all do pretty much the same thing. Each company has some slight variations on what they require, but it's not rocket science. So it provides the borehole logging geologists with information which will help them carry out their duties and their responsibilities. As with the CoalLog codes, it's hopefully going to provide a bit of consistency between the geologists out in the field and between the various companies. What we wanted to do was to really highlight the critical data to be collected and to make sure that was of a higher standard than maybe has been done in the past. And also to highlight the importance and the value of all the data that is being collected. It becomes a significant asset to each company, and I think that's often forgotten about in terms of the value of the data we collect. So it can be used as a basis for training people before they go out. It can be used as a reference for people when they're out in the field. However, anybody wants to make use of it, it's available. So without showing every single chapter heading, this really is what the document is about. It's the duties of a rig geologist, right through from the preparation before going out into the field, when the borehole is set up and calculating the depths, standard logging practice both for chip holes and core holes, how to take useful photos. I'm sure we've all seen plenty of photos that weren't very useful. How to take good samples, likewise. Some information on geophysical logging, a section on geotech logging, and then the sort of tasks that need to be completed at the end of the drilling program. Hopefully you can read this, but what we have delivered assumes that the geologists using the manual have a sound knowledge of general geology and especially coal geology. So we're not running a university course here. We're saying apply what you've learnt when you get out in the field, standing next to a drill rig and trying to collect the information. So it provides background information and references. There is an appendix which gives a whole lot of details about different drilling equipment, types of boreholes, and the issue that that you're going to encounter during drilling, and it provides procedures for photography and sampling, as well as the use of geophysical logs. It's an independent document, but obviously we wanted to tie as closely as we could to the CoalLog logging system. So when there's reference made to a logging sheet or to a field or to a code that's used in CoalLog, then those things are highlighted accordingly. So what are the key features? It has some lists of procedures. So you could take that out, those out, and put them on an independent document or in a just on a sheet so that somebody can have it in their notes in the field. Similarly with some of the diagrams and photo examples, so that it's readily available in front of somebody. Hopefully it includes a lot of the best practice, and I'm sure there's room for improvement and further development of what's in there, but we hope that we've captured that. As I said, it provides direct reference to the CoalLog sheet fields and codes, and it provides hopefully a comprehensive field reference. As all things do these days, it starts off with some comments on safety, but it's not a safety training manual. It's a geology and geotech logging manual. So it's really just some thoughts to start off with. But a key part of safety and of obviously of doing the job properly is about communication. So there's some comments regarding that. And the sorting of planning and preparation that's needed. What sort of equipment do you need to get together? What is the data that you're going to be collecting? What about the site preparation? And even considerations of food and water. So hopefully by the time the logging geologist has gone through all of those, he's pretty well prepared. As I say, there are some tables and hopefully some useful references in there that can just be taken out and used independently. So here's a checklist of all the equipment that you might need for a logging program, and you can just print that off and tick it off for each program as you do it. So some consideration of what the best practice is in terms of data collection, some pointers on surveying the borehole, and useful diagram like this, and a couple of points in terms of calculating borehole depths. And I'll talk a little bit later about the drilling sheets, which we've included a lot of new fields in to assist with this. So obviously we're covering chip logging, layout logging, sampling, and core logging, which is obviously a major chunk of the document. And I've probably talked already a little bit about what those different aspects are. You'll note at the bottom we do talk about the gas observations, and in CoalLog there's some description around what you might see with the core when it comes out. It's not about measuring the gas. I mean, there are separate procedures and instruction manuals all about gas samples and gas measurements. So that's not part of this document. It's really about the observation of gas in the core. So hopefully there you find these diagrams and photos useful in terms of illustrating the sort of things that are being talked about, in terms of getting some consistency in terms of core photos, the sort of information that might be marked up on the core or the core board that then provides you with useful photos later on. Something that, 5 years' time or 10 years' time, somebody can look at and understand what was being done. And relates obviously to the data that's been collected. Geotech logging, and I want to particularly thank Paul McConaughey and Tom Sullivan for their contributions to this section. I don't claim to be a geotech geologist, so we were really dependent on them putting the content of this in. But hopefully, again, it provides more detail and more reference to the logging geologist about what information needs to be collected and how to do it. Similarly with logs drilling, and what gets done there is a little bit different to your basic chip holes. So some of that is discussed. So as far as the geotech side of things concerned, hopefully some useful diagrams and descriptions and photos for the different aspects there, such as RQD, preparing geotech samples, how to classify slaking. So it actually goes a little bit further than the CoalLog codes that we've actually got and provides a little bit additional information on geotech logging. We don't just sample the rocks anymore when we go out to a drill rig. There's a lot of other things that get sampled, so there's some description around those procedures. And geophysical logging, we had a lot of discussion within the committee about providing information about depth adjustment. As I'm sure most of you are aware, there are a number of different ways in which people approach that, whether it's manually or using computers. It was very hard to settle on something that was standard practice, if you like, even though you would think it would be something that everybody would do the same. So this is really all about collecting data in the field and making sure that that's done as well as possible, rather than whatever might be done to the data once it's taken away from the field. So the key aspect here is really about what information do you want from the logger. So there's some questions there, some key comments to think about making sure the logger gives you that information. I mean, prior to that, the logger might want some key information from you, so that's listed there as well. But these are key points that are often not considered, and then when you come to look at or use the data later, you don't know how any of these have been dealt with. So we felt that was a much more important and useful aspect to the manual. And as I said, what happens at the end of the data collection process, it doesn't actually stop there. Something else gets done to the borehole through to rehabilitation. So there's some sections around that. And probably the final part of that and the key part is actually checking that you've got all the data that you need to in a suitable format that can be utilised down the track. And then there's a number of appendices there. As I previously said, there's some basic drilling information which was provided, which is very useful. And a lot of us are probably familiar to using the AusIMM Field Geologist Manual because it's got some useful diagrams and charts and so forth. The key ones of those are provided in this manual now, so that you don't have to have the two documents. So, coal brightness and roundness charts and so forth are there available. Any questions? I know it's very difficult to respond when you haven't got the full manual in front of you, and I'm sure when you start looking at it, there'll be all sorts of comments and questions, which you're welcome.
Yes, Roger. I don't answer this, but why was there such resistance to providing the manual?
Sorry?
Why would companies resist providing the manual? What's the big secret?
They think it's commercial in confidence. They've got their own procedures, and I suppose they've spent plenty of time and money developing their own manuals, and they didn't want to provide them holus bolus. So we got over that. But as I said, it took a lot longer than really to put this together. We had a couple of manuals which formed the basic framework, and then because we had a good cross-section on the committee of consultants and company people, we were able to insert and modify as necessary.
Yeah, many of whom would have used all the different manuals.
Well, that's right, yes. Yeah, they had their own manuals to refer to. They weren't actually necessarily provided, so... But a lot of the load at the end did fall to yours truly to put it together and make sure all the gaps were filled. So I have to shoulder that one. No, the budget doesn't extend that far. The budget is negative as it is. So yeah.
We've got
be on the website.
Go for your life, that's right. It will be, yes, very shortly.
It's not there yet.
Not there yet, no. Because there are a lot of other files that make up the whole of the CoalLog, and we're going to talk about the modifications to the codes and the sheets and so forth now. We aim to get all of those ready first before we put them all up there together. Well, that hasn't quite happened before today. But because this is a standalone document, then I'll be providing that to ACARP and to AusIMM tomorrow, and hopefully they'll have it up as soon as possible. If anybody is desperate for it before then you're welcome to contact me directly, and I'll send you the PDF copy. See me afterwards, and I'll give you my email, or my cards are on the table there. So,
I guess part of the answer to that is that we printed out the original CoalLog manual because we originally had more funds. Also, at that stage, we're trying to sell the idea of CoalLog because we're now convinced it's sold enough. People will just go and download what needs
to be done. All right.
It's 26.
144 pages in total, I think. Yeah, that's right.
Dave, just a quick one.
Yeah.
In the other sampling you have here in the table of content, I can't see the friction ignition samples, samplings, which is nowadays when we are target is deeper and deeper. We are normally taking samples
right.
from our core for friction and ignition. Is there?
Yep. All right, so room for an update. As I said, it won't necessarily be all things to all people, but BMA would like to provide that section that they've got, then we can add it to a future edition of the manual. Which, it's really what it's all about, what CoalLog has always been all about. It's like, let's use what's already in place out there because it's generally in common use, and make it available across the industry, so we've got standard procedures and a little bit more consistency. As we've indicated throughout, this isn't a static system. We were very pleased when we released the initial standard 3 years ago that there was very little feedback afterwards in terms of contentious issues that generally seeing people were quite happy to implement the codes and the fields that we use. But, gradually we got a little bit more feedback and people saying, oh, can we have this code? Can we have this field? Our system's got this. How do we translate that? We end up with non-standard codes or non-standard fields. It's been a process of updating and modifying with one key, proviso, and that is that we don't want to change any of the existing codes. We're generally happy to add to them. The size of a field might change in response to what's more efficient or effective, but we haven't wanted to actually change any of the codes so that nobody has to go back through their system and adjust everything again. And I think we've been reasonably successful in doing that. We've had two previous updates, the version 1.1 and 1.2, which so the modifications were provided on the website and the updated codes made available. And I guess if people were aware, then they've downloaded those. But they were just some incremental changes. Now we've got some quite considerable additions and changes. So we've got a version 2. In your packs, you've got a list of what all of these modifications are, and again, this document will be available on the website. So I'm going to take you through those now, so that you've got a pretty good idea of what's changed. Just some general things. First of all, a very basic one: we just changed hole to borehole on all of the sheets. There was some inconsistency about the order of some of the codes, and we've made sure that they're now consistent in terms of their grain size or the percentage, just in terms of the way they're listed on the coding sheets. There were some inconsistencies in the version 1.2 of the document, and so that's been corrected. One of the updates that we had was to add matrix supported and class supported coats, and that went out in version 1.2 in I think in sedimentary features in the dictionary descriptions, but in textures in the field itself. So that's been clarified. They are included in textures. So that might be something that people have got to go back through their data and adjust, but hopefully that's pretty straightforward. And cobbles was added to the work file and dictionaries, which hadn't been there before, even though it was a code that was in the system. We have a new sheet for sample dispatch data, so that's required the addition of some new fields, which are just those five. These are common to most people's systems. Some people may have more or less, but those are now available. And there's considerable additions to the fields for drilling data, which I'll show you in a moment, ends up being a very long line if you try and fit it all into one sheet, so that we've split those up into three recommended sheets. So I'll bring those up now and we can have a look at what those changes actually look like. So looking at the whole status sheet for starters, header data, so that now includes a field for the basin code. There's an adjustment made to the data status field, and you can now record four different borehole purposes. So, you know, it's just meant adding some fields, and the same with borehole status. There's now two fields on that sheet for recording borehole status, and obviously two fields in the database itself. So more information can be recorded there. Casing has had some, and just as we go through these, if you see something in red text, it's where it's there's been a change. So just the title here has been changed, and the title there because of change from hole to borehole. And rather than just the date, it's the date surveyed because there's other dates recorded in other sheets. So that's those. Anything that's in yellow is where it's changed. Anything that's in green is a new field. So you can see for casing, there's quite a few additional fields that have been put in there to help you record more information. Previously, there was only one size, but now it's possible to record both the outside diameter and the inside diameter of the casing. And if we just go across the cementing method, there's a field there now for that. Okay, so that covers that sheet. Drilling data. Let me show you what we now have. As I said, if we included all of the fields in one line, it becomes a rather long line. So when you collect the data, you may choose to have something like that, but we've provided some recommended separate sheets, three separate sheets. So the first one records the drill details. So the size of the rig number and the rig type fields have changed. Hopefully that doesn't cause any great drama, but that was part of the checking that the review committee did. The response was that it wasn't really going to affect anybody. This is a sheet for recording the changes that happened down the hole, either in terms of the driller, the date, the core size or the hole size. Each time that's changed, you can provide a different record. So you might want to record a size record number and a separate depth for that. The items in blue are to show that there's a relationship between other similar fields on the other sheets. If you're collecting all of this data, you would obviously want to make sure that when you start coring, that there's, you know, that's a separate depth record, it's a separate lot of information. It's going to have a separate record as well in terms of the hole size perhaps or the core size. But when you're actually calculating your depth of the hole, there's a whole lot of information you're going to collect for that. So you can record each of those separate bits of information about that. If you just want to manually calculate that and record it, you can do it and record it in that field. Or if you're happy to let the computer, if you're logging straight into a tablet or a computer, there are fields which we're saying that the computer will calculate for you. Now, it's possible to have both the manual calculation and the computer calculation there, and you might want to compare those later to make sure you got them right. But these are standard fields that people are going to want to see that are based on this information that you collect. And the third sheet is really more about the actual runs, particularly the core runs, new fields for the time that it's collected, a tick box for or yes or no box if you've taken a photo of that core run. Obviously, both the driller's depth and the geologist's depth can be recorded, and you can record what the length of the driller said it was going to be and what you as the geologist actually believe that it was, and you can have a manual calculation of what the loss and the gain was, again compared to the calculated field, which is back here. So those are the drilling sheets. Not much change to the lithology sheet other than some of those header names. The water observation sheet, I don't remember what the changes were to those fields.
Number of characters,
yep. And there was an error in the sheet with just in terms of the number of columns for the borehole name. Just the position of the defect type column was moved in the new sheet. And so let me make the point again here, just so that it's quite clear. These are just the sheets that we put together, so that if you want to just take the system as it was designed, print off a sheet for using out in the field or setting this up on your tablet for recording, you can go ahead and use these. But these are all separate fields that will be in your database, and you can use whichever ones you want and arrange them however you want on your logging sheets. It's really just these have some common purpose and some flow to them, and obviously they are based on what is in common use out there anyway. Some of the changes have been made is just totally to make them easier to use. So point loads, I don't think there was any change.
Excuse me, a comment I should make on these. Where fields are coloured, like those ones are purple, the coloured ones are the compulsory fields.
Yep. Okay. So, any questions about any of those sheets, fields, codes, changes, updates? So you can take this modifications sheet back to your database person and say, please add these fields, please add these codes, so that you bring your CoalLog logging system up to version 2 status. For those that haven't been at previous meetings, one of the things we did just decide when people said, well, we've got this field, it's not a CoalLog tendered field, how do we deal with that? You can still store it in your database, but if it's ever output for transfer, then put custom underscore in front of that field name so that we know that it's not a CoalLog field. Similarly with any codes, they may need to be distinguished. So,
in addition to any processing certain code data from one of the things I would find useful in processing is actually
a lithology code on the point load data sheet.
Yeah, because when you're processing, you generally want to know.
I would argue that CoalLog is a data collection.
Yeah.
So that information is elsewhere. and it's extremely useful. So we don't want the dollars collecting it more than once. We don't, and for that, one reason we don't want the collecting it more than once is you don't want the calling to the defective to the run to the machines. So I would argue that that's a deficiency with the software systems that you're using. To put the two together. It should be up to the software to do that, not the dollars. I'm not saying that there are software systems that do currently do that.
I'm not sure. I've been putting it together manually,
but you don't want the job just recording it twice. So you really have to have software to have that problem.
Joe.
I'm just interested why
I'll
let Dave answer that question.
I don't know that I have a.
Oh, don't you?
An easy answer for it. It was because there was another whole set of fields that started with G.
Yeah. The answer to that was that we ended up with so many whole purposes in the modifications after we had feedback that we had to sort of subgroup them. So we subgrouped them by actually using the first letter of the purpose to subgroup them. And we wanted to use the letter G for, what was it, gas?
For gas, yeah.
For gas. So, it came about from the fact that we were trying to group things together and we wanted to use the G for gas.
And again, these codes came from a company that already had developed a whole lot of borehole purpose codes and these subcodes. So that was the, it either meant changing one code, which was Geotech, or it meant changing all of their gas codes. So apologies, that is one case where there has been a change. Well, that's right, but people do record that, and that's why we've extended the purpose fields to being four fields now that people can record all the different purposes.
Interesting, in our discussions we found that Anglo actually has 16 fields in their database for whole purpose.
What we've given you so far is the successful outcomes of the project. There were two aspects which we weren't quite so successful at. The intention or objective was to put photographs with all of the descriptive codes. When we did version one, there were some supplied at the time, but after some consideration, we decided not to use them because one, they weren't referenced, and two, they were inconsistent in terms of their style, format, quality, and so forth. So it was suggested with version two, we would come up with something that was consistent and properly referenced. Again, the objective was to go out there and find something that was there readily available. And people were very quick and keen to point out to us that there were some photographs set that had been done in Queensland by a CSIRO some years ago. And also Colin Ward had produced a set down in New South Wales. We did have a look at those. And some of those photos have been used in the general text for sedimentary structures and a couple of other things, but we found that they didn't readily apply to the simple lithology code or the simple codes that we were using, basic codes we were using in CoalLog. There was usually a multiplicity of features that were shown in those CSIRO pictures, and they certainly didn't cover the full set of even lithology codes that we had. The set that Colin Ward took, I have to admit, I've never seen them. I'm sure a lot of people from New South Wales have seen them. But when we started investigating that, we found that it wasn't quite clear who actually owned the photos. They were taken by somebody in the department who had now retired. The ownership of the publication had changed from a couple of different organisations, and nobody was no longer sure just where it resided. And because the originals had been taken by this person who had retired, and nobody seemed to have contact details, that wasn't going to work out either. So given the lack of suitable source of adequate photos and a long way short of sufficient time and funds to be able to go out and collect a set, this part of the project did not succeed. Maybe somebody wants to take it up for the future, and good luck. But it's, you know, it's a nice idea, but it's not something that was easily achieved.
You're probably aware that in LAS files there's a lot of information that's actually metadata that's actually stored in the header of the file. Information pertaining to how, when, which, who, and where the geophysical variables were recorded. Yeah, the LAS format specifies a very basic set of metadata in the well section of the LAS file, basically hole name, logging company, date logged, etc. The other thing that the LAS standard does is it actually specifies the parameter section, which enables you to set up all your own variables and give them values and units and etc. But the problem here is, and the LAS standard is such that that's extremely flexible. You can set up whatever parameters you want to store there. But because it is extremely flexible, every logging company has a different set of parameters or has at least different variable names for the same parameters, etc. All right, so briefly, what I did was I went through a whole pile of LAS files that I've got from various sources, and I went through here and listed what parameters in different different sources people have been recording. So I've got azimuth, bit size, bit type, calibration, casing depth driller, casing depth logger, casing depth diameter, casing stick up, casing thickness, casing type, casing weight, datum driller, data log, drill by, drilling date, easting, elevation, filter width, fluid density, fluid level, fluid type, geodetic datum, inclination, log by, logging speed, logging unit model, etc., etc. And then using different sources of data, so I've got some data from Mongolia, data from borehole wireline services, Rutherford's, which also is the same as Century, slimline logging services, as used by a couple of our clients, Geolog Wilkie Creek, another Mongolian one, that used by AGL, Weatherford's, that used by New Hope, that used by QCOL. And you can see here that, for example, looking at casing driller's depth, Century uses the code CASB, slimline logging services use CASI, Weatherford use CSGD, New Hope uses CAS-STOP. So you can see what the problem is now that when it's put up on a page like that, how that it makes it very difficult if you're actually trying to automate, you know, using the LAS software, where you've got, you know, different companies collecting it, how difficult it is to actually grab this data out off the LAS file. So what we've done here is we've put together a document. Now, what I say is why this is not complete. I've actually put this document together and distributed it for comment. So we're not putting it out as part of the standard at this stage. We're sort of waiting for comment. We've had one meeting of the LAS people that were interested in assisting with the LAS stuff, and this has come out. I've developed this since the time of that meeting. So we're still waiting to have another couple of meetings and discuss all this. What I've suggested, and at this stage this is still a draft, is that we should actually have the logging companies always putting in bit size, casing depth logger, casing outside size, casing stick up, casing type, datum for the logger, where they measured their zeros from, fluid level, log by, total depth of logger, and who the witness was. These are the mnemonics for those variables. And then suggesting these other possible parameters that they may like to collect, and here's a list of codes for each of those parameters. So I'll just show you where that's at, but this is not really, as of yet, in the version 2 until we get it more ratified by various groups. Because one of the things we've always tried with CoalLog is not to actually come up with a system and then enforce it onto people. We've tried to actually get these committees together to come up with consensus about how they should be done. And it's amazing, when we first started this process, we started trying to do this by teleconference and emails. And you find that people can get very antagonistic to each other when they're dealing through emails or teleconferences. Whereas when they're in the same room, it's surprising how some people who you'd never think would agree manage when they're in the same room to come to some sort of agreement. So it does mean dragging people up from New South Wales or down from Queensland, but we've been surprised when you get people in the same room how much consensus you can actually get. But when you start doing it over the internet, you tend to find it just falls to pieces. I guess before I finish, there's a couple of other comments that I thought of while we were speaking. As you see there, there's a list of the modifications that were made between the earlier releases and release two. If you go to the web site, that modifications document, which is not quite up yet, not only has the differences between two and earlier versions, it also has the differences between version 1, 1.1 and 1.2. So if you've actually implemented version 1, and you want to catch up on all the different differences that have been seen, not that there's many, because obviously, you know, you might have all the system, all in databases in your system, and you just want to change the databases or the dictionaries in your system. You don't want to start again from scratch. Those list of modifications will all be up on the website. Another comment I thought of is one of the negative comments, feedback we've received from people about CoalLog is, oh, it's way too extensive and covers too much and has too many columns and columns aren't in the order we want. Well, one of the things we said right from the outset was that we were trying to come up with a system that catered for everybody so that everything was there, you know, everything that they'd want would be there. But there's no compulsion to use everything. There's a few compulsory fields, like for lithology, the only two compulsory fields are depth and lithotype. But there's a few compulsory fields, but you can drop out any of the fields you want. You're also free to move the fields into some different order. It's just that you want to use those. Those are the fields to use. And the same with the dictionary, especially things like said features. We went to enormous lengths to come up with said features that most people have never heard of since they finished their undergraduate course or whatever. But they're there if somebody wants to use them. There's no reason why you have to keep them in your dictionary. The idea was that we wanted to make sure everything was there so that people didn't have something that they wanted to go and make up a code for. But there's no compulsion to include everything. You can cut 90% of the dictionary out if that's what you so want to do, and you're still CoalLog compatible. But I think it's important to make those couple of points. On the modifications too, I guess one note in the modifications, we have been saying that nearly all our modifications were additions to the system, not changes to the system. I guess one of the exceptions was between release 1 and 1.2, we realised that we really hadn't covered abundances really well, clearly. So if you're looking at version 1, I can't remember the exact things. It was things like occasional. We actually cut occasional out, even though it was in version 1, because it just didn't fit in with a more comprehensive abundance system. But I just warned that that's the only thing that we actually had to do a major rethink of between versions 1 and 1.2, and did have to cut some things out that were in the first version. All right. As we said, phase 2 has included the geological and geotechnical training manual. And what we succeeded with is the plotting symbols for lithologies and qualifiers, standardised stratigraphic and seam names, and an update of the logging sheets and code dictionaries. And I guess the important thing to say is that as we keep trying to reiterate, this is not frozen in time. And you know, if you want to be involved with any reviews, the aim has generally been probably every 12 months. It's been recently. We've had a review committee meeting about once every 6 to 12 months, and we've had one in Queensland and one in New South Wales. So if you're interested in being involved in the review process. CoalLogs, as we said, is freely available off the AusIMM website. The way you go to it, codes and accreditations, CoalLog standard. Because it's been downloaded so many times, if you type CoalLog into Google, you know, you'll go straight to the website. Interestingly, I've had some inquiries from places like Canada and South Africa from software developers that said, is this proprietary in any way? Are we free to use it in our software development? And I said, no, go for it. So it is actually being picked up elsewhere in the world, even without us promoting it, just through the web. All right, we'd like to thank... I'm sure there were other people that have contributed, but here's a short list of those that have made a contribution to the development of version 2. I'd like to thank everybody for their input. One of the things, as we've tried all along, is to try and get as wide a cross-section of people involved in the development as possible. Okay, I guess any questions? Comments? Yes, Carol. Oh, you want, oh, wait.
Yeah, yeah. Right back in stage one, we recognised that there were some codes that were in common use and would be in people's databases that either had very difficult translation to a new code or we wanted to discourage use of. So Brett mentioned before about cold inferior, which we felt didn't have any real meaning. But it's in a lot of people's databases. Is this there in the dictionary so that you can still have a valid dictionary, a valid set of data if it's included, but it's great so that we discourage any further future use. And that applies as well to the cold brightness code. There were two systems in use, which was a C1 to C8 set of codes and a brightness set of codes, and we've gone with the brightness descriptive codes rather than the C1s and the S1s for the sensors.
Thank you very much for your attendance today. We appreciate you coming along and giving the time, and we look forward to making use of CoalLog version 2.